Now I have the opportunity to introduce my own talk because we have this duty list, and somehow we managed to put me on the same duty list where I'm going to present. So now let me introduce you, Gábor Szabó, who is going to talk about PyTest mocking and fixtures in PyTest. What would you do if your goal is to land something on the moon? You would like to send a probe to the moon. How would you write your software? How would you write your system? You can't just send a probe every day and see what's going on and then improve it a little bit more and then send a new probe again, because it would be extremely time consuming and very costly. Now, of course, our projects might not be that ambitious, but still we might have issues that we can't always do the whole system, the whole process we can't always run. For example, you might have a web application where among many other things, it will try to let you register with your email. So if you type in your email, it will send an email to your email account with a code, and then you'll have to click on that code. And how can you test that? So one way to test it is to set up a Gmail account or some kind of other web-based email account or an email account somewhere, and then use that email to try your software, to always register with that software, then go out to the email provider, grab that code from there, and use that code to verify your email. But that's, again, it's not that time-consuming as flying to the moon, but it's still a lot more than you would like to spend on a unit test. It also very much depends on the availability of that service. So if you don't have network connection, then your whole test system will fail, even though your code might work well, but you can't test because of the third-party system that you were using for testing is not available. And of course, definitely you can't run your test when you're offline. Now you can have similar issues with other things. For example, if you want to create if your system uses random numbers or random values and you would like to create a repeatable test, you would need some way to make sure that you can repeat the same random numbers. Or what if you try to run your test in parallel? So you want to have two people running on the same system being able to run the test. You have to make sure that anything that they are using, a database or a file system, is not shared by the tests. Because if they are, then these tests can interfere with each other, and then one of the tests might fail or succeed, even though it's not the right thing to do for that test. So you definitely don't want your tests to interfere with each other. And what about third-party systems? So what if your application also interacts with some third-party system? How can you test your code without actually always using and always calling out to the third-party system? Of course, when you're trying to test the connection, that's a separate thing. But when you're trying to just test your system and you somehow rely on that third-party, that you have a problem. Because then, again, you rely on that third-party being available, the network connectivity, and you don't want to get false positives. And there's an even more interesting question. How do you test your system? How your system behaves when the third-party system is going to fail in production? How can you get the third-party system to fail during your test run? And so you can verify that your system is still running and it won't break just because Facebook, for example, or whatever other system is not available for that in that second when the user needs it. You can't get a third-party system to misbehave on purpose, usually. So you have to find some way to fake that third-party system. So you can tell it that now behave as if it was a failure, or actually just don't answer me. And then you can write your test around that and see what will your application do when the third-party fails. So my name is Gábor Szabó, as I was introduced earlier. I go to companies, I'm self-employed, I go to companies, I try to help them to improve their software development cycle. It's starting from version control in some cases, because sometimes I work with teams that they don't yet use version control or not use it properly. So I start from there sometimes. I help them write test automation, CI/CD systems, and sometimes it's called DevOps because that's a nice word these days. So let's go to fixtures, if this clicker would work. So fixtures, that's one of our topics in this talk. In the testing world, fixtures is the world that describes all the environment that you need in order to run your tests. So everything that from the file system, from a database, from external connections, everything, that's called a fixture. It's the same with the space program. The moon is the fixture. Now in PyTest, the word fixture is used for something more. In PyTest, the word fixture is used both for setting up the environment and maintaining the external environment, and also some other stuff that helps you check the test, check whether the test was successful or failed, and do all the kind of other interesting things with the test. So just so you know that the word fixture is slightly more covers slightly more in PyTest than in the general testing community. There are a couple of ways to write fixtures in PyTest. One of them is using the XUnit style, which is used by many other languages. And I'm not going to go into this part now, because we are going to see something else which is much more interesting in PyTest. And for this, the first example is using a temporary directory. So whenever your application needs to interact with the file system, if it needs to write a file or read some configuration file, you want to make sure that this, for every test, has a separate directory and the separate files to use. Why would you want to do this? Because you don't want, again, to two test runs or even two test cases in your own test run to use the same files, because then they might interact and then one test might fail, even though it's just because the interaction with the other test. So you want to have the separation. And what PyTest does is uses something in some places called dependency injection. I'm not sure that PyTest uses this expression for that, but that's basically the same idea. So here's the example of my code. It's a simple wrapper around JSON. It just has two functions. One is gets a data structure and the file name and can save that data structure as a JSON. The other one can read it. So it's just a very simple application. How can I test it? Well, the easy way is just to create a data structure, call the saving function, save it to a file, then call the loading function, and then compare the resulting data structure with the original one I had. And if I do it for a couple of data structures, then apparently it works. That's the test. Now for this, I can create a data structure, but I also need a file. I can hard code a file name, but if I hard code the file name, then two tests might interact because they have the same file name, they're using the same file. So for that, instead of that, I'm going to use a temporary directory, and in there, I'm going to have this file name. So the way it works in PyTest is that we create a testing function, def test something, and then we tell, in the definition, we tell that it's expecting an object called tmpdir. Now the name is important, because this tmpdir is a fixture. PyTest, when it runs the test, it will look at the test file, and it will see, oh, there is this testing function, and this testing function is expecting an object called tmpdir. It will look up in its list of fixtures, its existing fixtures, and it says, oh, I know what tmpdir is, and what tmpdir does is, in PyTest, is it PyTest will create a temporary directory and create an object called localpath out of it, and when it calls the test JSON function, it will send into pass this as a parameter, this object. Inside the function, I can use this object. I could use the methods of localpath, but I always forget how to use them. So instead of that, I use something much more simple. I convert it using str to a plain string, and that plain string just points to a directory, and from that point I understand the world, because now I have a path to a directory, which I know it's unique for my test case. So even if I have more test functions doing the same, they have their own directory. In that directory, I have a test file. The name is fixed, but it doesn't matter because the directory is unique. So it won't interact with other file names. And then I can create the data structure, some data structure, call the save method of my application, call the load method of my application, and then compare the resulting data structure with the one that I sent in. And that's basically the test. So now, with this simple parameter with this dependent in this dependency injection, I managed to have a temporary directory. I would ask what happens to this temporary directory after the test is run. So first of all, the directory looks something like this in Mac, something like this in Linux, and probably on Windows it also works. I've never tried it. The thing is that you can see one thing, that in each one of them, the file name, the path, has a number in it. So every time the PyTest runs, every time it creates a temporary directory, it will create one with a new number. And then the cleanup, so PyTest will automatically clean up these directories after the test runs, but it won't do it immediately. Actually, it will save three copies, the three most recent versions of it, which means that for one, it will clean up the older ones, but it also allows us to look at the temporary directory if the test fails and see what really happened there, what kind of stuff was saved there, and then try to figure out what might have been the problem. The next fixture that I would like to talk is called Capsys. It's there to allow us to capture standard output and standard error, whatever is printed out. Now, normally in an application, you would have a separate function to print to the screen and to the standard error, and separate function to do actual stuff. But in a real world, many applications have it intermixed. And so just we print out stuff during the application. So the way we can test it is that we'll need to be able to run these functions, see their exit values or the return values, but also to see if they're printed out to the standard output and standard error, whatever was expected to be there. So how does this work? Here is the super intelligent application I have. Just a simple function, gets two parameters, prints the first one to standard output, the second one to standard error. So we are going to test this one. And this is the test. So there's the test function. It receives a capsys, the word capsys, as a parameter, which basically tells PyTest to send in an object that can do this stuff, the output capturing stuff, whatever it is. Then I run the application. So this is the greet method, and I pass in two values, and then I can call the method, the readout_err method of this module, of the capsys, to get back whatever was captured by it on the standard output and standard error. It will return me two strings, whatever was printed to standard output and whatever was printed to standard error. And then I can use assert to compare those to whatever I expected to be printed during the running of this function. Of course, later on, I might refactor the function underneath, but I know that the standard output and the standard error doesn't change, or I can make sure. Later on, I call again the method of the application, and I can call grab again whatever was printed out to the standard output and standard error. Each call of this readout_err actually clears out the buffer. So when I call it again, it will only return those output and string that was created since the previous call of it. Okay, so this time I can check that the output is this word next, and the standard error was empty, which is really nice. Just so you know, you can actually put more than one parameters in these test functions, and PyTest will figure out, okay, you are looking for a temporary directory and the capsys object and maybe other things as well. PyTest has a couple of other fixtures as well, but we are not going to look at them now. Instead of that, we are looking at something else. We'll look at homemade fixtures. So in many cases, these fixtures help us, but in even more cases, we need some kind of a special fixture for our test purposes. So PyTest allows us to create these fixtures. And the first type of fixture is the inject fixture, basically what we saw earlier, that we are injecting in this dependency injection in the test function. The way we create it is that we have this, we define a function, which is going to be the fixture, and then we decorate it with PyTest fixture to tell PyTest that this is a fixture. So in this case, the config function is a fixture. That means that from now on, I can actually write tests that will accept this word config, and when PyTest sees it, and before it starts to run the test, it will call my config function, and whatever is returned by that config function is going to be passed into this testing function. So in this case, this is very simple. It just creates the data structure, but you can do anything in that function and then pass in, you can create an object there, you can set up some environment and pass in that object in the fixture. What you can notice here is a slight problem that we have the definition of the fixture and the test function in the same file, which of course is good as long as you have a single test file, but if you have multiple test files as you, and you would like to have the same fixture in multiple of these files, then you need them some other way. And PyTest provides us. PyTest allows us to move out our fixtures into a file called conftest. And if we have a file called conftest in the directory where the tests are, then PyTest will read those files, read that file, and do whatever the file says. So in this case, I moved out the fixture into this file and left the tests in the other file, in the test file. So now the test file doesn't directly know about the definition of the fixture, it can just use it, and now I can have multiple of these test files using the fixture I just created. Inject and yield. So we saw a case where we had a fixture that was executed, but the function of the fixture was executed before the test function was run. In this case, when you're using the yield expression in Python, what we can do is that we have a fixture, again marked with the PyTest fixture, with the decorator. But in this case, it doesn't return data, it yields the data. So what happens here is that when I use this fixture, PyTest will start running the function. Whatever yield returns is what PyTest sends into the testing function. And when the testing function ends, then PyTest will run the rest of the code in that fixture. So as you can see, it prints out before, which was at the beginning of the fixture, then the in-test and the data structure, which is in the test, and then the word after, which was after the yield in the test. So this allows us to clean up afterwards, after the test. And this part runs even if the test actually failed. So it's an important thing that you can create something, pass it into the testing function, and then afterwards you can clean up whatever you whatever happened there, whatever you created before, because you don't want to leave mess after the test, usually. The last one here is fixtures with auto-use. So far these inject things were nice, but it meant that we have to write for every test, we have to say, okay, this test gets this object, this test gets this object, this one. And if you have lots of tests, which is a good thing, then you have to write it a lot of cases. Now, sometimes, well, we don't want to write so much. So we can create a fixture that we can tell to run on every test function. And this is what auto-use does. So here we create a new fixture, but we mark it with auto-use. This means that this fixture will be executed before every test function that sees it, that's in its scope, in data structure, in the directory structure. Now, inside you can have either something return or something with yield, it doesn't really matter. In both cases it works, it's just the question whether it runs only before or both before and after the test. In the test, I don't have to mention anything, because this fixture runs automatically. Of course, it has the disadvantage that I don't have the object right now, I don't have any object in the test like we had with the inject, but on the other hand, I don't have to run or write anything in the test function. So both disadvantages and advantages. In the last thing about fixtures, just a simple example, I had this application where I was using MongoDB, and I needed, and in the test I wanted to have a separate database for each test run, because I didn't want them to interact with each other. One creates some data, the other is surprised by having some data there. So what I had is this fixture, which is a very simple, it's a very simplified version of what I really have, but I wanted to show something. So it is auto-use fixture, something with configuration. It creates a database name with just a timestamp. It could be better, but the timestamp is good enough for me. It just has to be a unique name, okay? And then I define variable, an environment variable that will be used by the application. So this one is actually needed some change in the application as well. In the real one, I think I was using just a configuration file, but it would have been just way too much on the slide here. But then the point is here that I have this environment variable with the database name. Now I call yield, which means that now actually the test runs, any test function runs. So now the application can see the environment variable and see, oh, this is the name of the database I have to use. And then the nice part is that once the test is done, I use this getMongo method from the application actually to get the database, and then I delete the database. So I clean up. So I won't have hundreds or thousands of small databases in my database server just because I was running tests. So that's just a sort of real-world example. Now the slightly separate subject of this talk is test doubles. So who has ever heard about test doubles? Very few people, that's good. So test doubles is a word created by Gerard Mészáros, and it's basically a definition of five different things that you can see here. Most of us, I think we just use these words interchangeably. He created this description, and each one has a slightly different definition. And if you really want, you can go and read his book and try to understand the differences. The general point is that if you are reading about this, then you know that there are more or less, for all purposes, they are more or less the same. But there are definitely different, there could be differences in some cases between these things like dummies and spies and mocks and so on. But we're not going to talk about actually about this. We're going to talk about monkey patching. So monkey patching is basically one of the ways to implement mocking or faking or whatever. There are other ways as well, but languages like Python support monkey patching, and that we are going to use that. So monkey patching is basically just replacing a method or some attribute on the fly. So instead of going into the source code and replacing something, which is bad because no one wants to change the actual application just for the purpose of the current test. So instead of that, during the test run, we replace some internal part of the application with something that's much more, much better for us for writing our test. So that's monkey patching. A couple of ways, places when you would use, when you're writing using TDD and you're writing unit tests, and of course in unit tests you don't want to run all the other parts of the system, so you would mock them or fake them or whatever you call them, okay? And you can use monkey patch for that. In the real world, you just have spaghetti code around and you have to test that, but you can't test a spaghetti code, any part of it standalone, so you have to create the whole system. Because everything is depends on everything. But monkey patching, or in general, mocking, can help us because we can replace some part of the system with stuff that we control, and then we can test the rest of the system, the smaller parts of the system, much better. And again, the third-party systems, what I mentioned earlier, can be mocked or simulated, or that's a new word for it. So simulated in order to test the third-party system. And you can tell the simulator now to break, and then it will to stop working or return some incorrect data. And then we can test our system, how our system behaves when an incorrect data is returned by the third-party system. So the first and rather simple problem is the hard-coded pass. You might have seen it. I saw it many, many times, that you have this application and then some hard-coded pass, which is some weird place in the operating system. Now, this is fine for the application, as long as you have a single version of the application running on a single system. But once you want to test it, it's really problematic, because now, if I have two tests running at the same time, maybe you want to have your tests run in parallel, or two people running in the test, or you're using a CI system where you might have two versions running at the same time, you can't really have a single file in the same place, because then you have the same configuration for every test, and then you can't test the configurations. And in any way, in CI systems, usually don't have access to these weird places in the operating system because they restrict your locations. So how can we test this? Well, this is the test for it, one of the tests, the first ones. Here I loaded the application itself in the test file and then replaced the app data file with something I wrote here. Now, of course, I could use here a temporary directory. That would be even better. But it's much better already because now the application is going to look for at this file. Okay? The problem with this are two main problems. One of them is that if it wasn't in red, you wouldn't notice that I'm doing this. So you would have a huge test script and you wouldn't understand where does it get the configuration from. And the second one is that this change in this test function is actually global. So the next text function is still seeing this configuration file. So you can't really run this test function alone because now it depends on the other one. Okay, so and then that's not a good idea to have these test functions interdependent on each other. So there is a better way, actually, not this home-created solution. I can use the monkey patch fixture of PyTest in order to do this. So the fixture is called monkey patch, and what you do is call monkey patch set attribute. You pass basically the same parameters to it, and it does exactly the same as I did, except that one. Now you can see I'm doing monkey patching because it's in the definition of the function, so you can search for it, and that makes it easier to locate these things. And second, this is now specific for this test function. So the next text function, it is not changed by, and it's not nothing changed by in the application by this change. So you of course you have to repeat this. That's a problem. That might be a problem, but at least you don't have interaction between the test functions. Another thing that we can mock is methods. So here I have a small Flask application. This is the application and the test of it. And please read it. That's so it has one route that accepts. This is basically the one that I told you about. People registering with email. It sends out an email, and then the person has to click on the link in the email to verify that that's their email address. So there is one route where you type in your email address and it generates, what does it do? It saves to the database the email and the code that was generated and then creates an HTML and sends calls the send mail function to send out this email to that email address that was given. And then it returns okay or failed. It's not a beautiful application apparently. The second route is called verify, and it gets the email and the code, and then it calls the DB verify function that will get the code and the email, checks the database whether this pair is there, and then it returns okay or not okay, and it sends out a welcome email to the person if it was okay. So how do I, and what you can see here is the send mail function wasn't even actually implemented in this example, because I don't need the send mail function in order for the test to work. And of course, that's an issue with mocking, that you might have everything running, but you haven't implemented half of your application yet. So remember that. But at least we can test the application without implementing send mail and without actually sending out emails. So this is the test. It uses monkey patch, and it creates the application under test, this AUT, whatever, Fluxing, it doesn't matter. Created a list called messages where the emails are going to be saved. And here comes the monkey patching. So I replace the send mail function of this application with a simple lambda function that just gets a parameter, the single parameter that the send mail was getting, and puts at the end of this list, the messages list. And that's it. And then I can run a post. I can send in a post request. And I have to finish it. Yes, I know. I send in a simple post request, check whether the result was OK. And here I print out the message, which it looks like this. But it's much better to actually grab the code from it and then send back the code with the verification. And then I can assert whether the next message is that email that I was expecting after the verification. So now, without actually sending out any email, I could internally check whether those emails are correct. And the last thing I did here is that I called verify method with some incorrect data, and then I checked whether it returned failed. Sorry, not this one, the next slide. Whether it returned failed. and I checked whether whether there was any message, because there was there's not supposed to be any message. So I'm checking whether I don't send any email by mistake. Mocking can be used with all kinds of other things, for example, input-output and API testing, timestamps, and if you are trying to fly to the moon, you can actually mock the moon as well. Thank you very much.